Today I'm going to go through some of the most common braking technique issues I'm used to seeing, and I'll show you how you can use data analysis to both understand and rectify these problems for yourself. I'm going to use some log data from one of our own cars that we gathered at a recent race event. I'm going to go through these log data examples using Motec's i2 software, but it's not going to matter which data analysis system you're using, all of these concepts apply equally. The first problem I want to talk about today is drivers not getting to peak brake pressure early enough. This is one of the most common things you'll see amateur drivers doing, where when they go to apply the brake pedal, they're not getting to the peak pressure early in the stop. The idea is that you do want to build the pressure up relatively aggressively before then bleeding off for corner entry. So I've got some log data up here on my laptop screen. From top to bottom here, this is the speed channel. We've got the throttle position, the brake pressure, steering wheel angle, and the gear position. Now the thing I really want to focus on here is the rate at which the driver is building their brake pressure here. We've got this driver, we can see they're accelerating here through the section of the track because the speed trace is rising, they're lifting off the throttle and then applying the brake pedal. So we can see here that the driver is pretty linearly ramping up the pressure here until they get to the peak and then an abrupt bleed off at the end. Now what we really want to see, the ideal shape here, is going to be something like a relatively steep rise followed by a bleed off to corner entry, something like that. We really want to be getting the brake pressure up as quickly as possible before bleeding off. Now the optimum rate of brake pressure application is different for every car. For some cars you're going to be able to go very, very aggressively, something that's very stiffly sprung, something like a single seater or a prototype, but something that's more based on a road car, something like a GT or maybe even your road car that you're doing a little bit of local competition in, you're not going to be able to build that brake pressure quite as aggressively as you can in something like a single seater. In saying that, this particular example that I'm showing here, this is far too slow of how the brake pressure is being built. We still want the all of that peak pressure to happen at the start of the stop up here before bleeding off. The reason that's so important is because the start of the stop, where the car is still traveling in a relatively straight line, this is where we want to retard most of the speed off the car. This is the safest place to do it. It's also the fastest place to do it because you're not trying to add any extra load into the side of the car by trying to do more braking later into the stop. This might seem like a really obvious point, but you'd be surprised just how many people do this. This really highlights the advantage of using data analysis in motorsport, where you might feel like you're doing one thing on track, but by logging it and being able to go back and see exactly what you did in the lap before or in the outing before, this is a massive advantage and it does show you things that you don't pick up when you're actually driving the car on track. Now just to highlight that point about getting the brake aggression right, I've added an overlay here into my data. So over here on my laptop screen, you'll see the original data is shown here in red, and I've got this overlay of a white line here, which is actually of a different driver in the car. So you can see here the huge difference in braking technique. Essentially these two things are completely opposite to each other. We've got the white driver here braking relatively aggressively, getting to peak pressure and then bleeding off, whereas we've got original data here with the driver very slowly, just gently applying the brake pressure until they get to their peak, followed by a sudden release. So this white line here, this white driver, is something much closer to what we want to be achieving. The second common braking problem I want to talk about is drivers braking too early. Now that's something that you'll usually hear referred to as braking points or braking markers. That simply means the position on track that the driver is starting their brake application. Over here on my laptop screen, I've got two sets of data shown. I've got one which is shown in color here and an overlay which is shown in white. Now looking at the brake pressure trace, we can see quite clearly that one driver is braking quite a lot earlier than the other. Now it's important to take note here that we have got a distance display down the bottom. This means this scale down the bottom here is shown in a distance scale and not a time scale. And it's really important to understand that we want to be plotting over distance rather than time when we're doing these sorts of driver overlays. So while we can see that there's a difference between them and where the how early one driver is braking with respect to the other, what we really need to do, and one of the big advantages with motorsport data analysis, is we can put a number to it. So here, I'll show you a technique. We can put my cursor here at where one driver is approximately braking. I'm going to press the space bar, which is going to give us a delta, and then I put the other cursor where the second driver is starting to brake. Now, one of the ways we can see where how big that difference is down the bottom here. We can see there is 23 meters of difference. So that means the driver with the white data is braking 23 meters earlier than the other. Now, in racing terms, 23 meters is a massive amount. To go about fixing this, the first thing you need is to identify some references on the track that you can use to help move your braking markers forward. What I mean by that is either some a line in the track, maybe a mark on the wall next to the track. The idea behind using braking references is it means that you can identify some position on track to understand where you were braking and to know how much further forward you need to brake relative to the faster driver. The last braking technique point I want to talk about today is drivers not modulating the brake pressure well enough while they're changing down gears during braking. This is generally a problem in cars that have conventional gearboxes where the driver needs to use the clutch on the downshift. Now, the problem with that is because their left foot is taken up using the clutch, that means when the engine is going to be blipped, they need to use their right foot to blip the throttle while they're also using the brake pedal. This is what people refer to as heel and toe braking. Now, heel toeing is a difficult technique and it does take a lot of practice to get it right. The reason it's so difficult is because you've got so much pressure on the brake pedal while you're trying to modulate it. At the same time, you're trying to use the side or the back of your foot to try and hit the accelerator pedal to blip on the downshift. It just becomes really difficult to keep a consistent modulation on the brake pedal while you're trying to use your foot for something else at the same time. Having unsteady brake pressure during a braking zone can be quite unsettling for the car. That's both in terms of changing the rake of the car as it dives down up into the corner, and also it can introduce problems with wheel locking, particularly inside front wheel locking on corner entry. So over here on my laptop screen, I've got an example of exactly this situation going on. I've got a driver driving a car with a conventional gearbox going down the gears here, and they're doing a blip that we can see here. So here's where they're entering the corner when the throttle drops off. Down here, they're dropping completely off the throttle and then doing a blip when the gear change occurs. You can see in the brake pressure trace here, they're doing a relatively good job of building brake pressure relatively quickly. But this discontinuity, that's this section here that we see, this is all coming from this blip here. So there's a couple of things I see here. This blip, for one thing, is really big. Throttle blips, the amount you need to blip it will depend on the type of engine and your configuration, the mass of your flywheel, things like this. But in this case, the driver's essentially going back to 100% throttle. That's not usually required. And the bigger blip you do on the throttle, the more difficult it's going to be to modulate your brake pressure. And as a result, we see this relatively big discontinuity in the brake pressure trace here. This is exactly what we're trying to avoid. And this is, as you can see, something that we can only really see in the log data. Now, all of these braking problems I've gone through today are discussed in detail along with a whole lot more in both our data analysis fundamentals course and our professional motorsport data analysis courses. If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you subscribe. We're constantly releasing new videos, and if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description of this video to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.